Hey everyone, before we get started this week, I just want to take a moment. This is Spencer from the Pods We Cast Along the Way.
And this is Ryan, also from the Pods We Cast Along the Way.
And we were very privileged this week to make a guest appearance on another podcast called the Paranormal Burrito. So if you're a fan of this show and you're a fan of anything particularly spooky or anything involving the paranormal, it's a big thing out there on podcasting right now. Make sure you go check it out. Anyways, enjoy this week's show. Do you want to do a sincere reflection on one of our favorite moments from the past few episodes?
No.
Okay. In a world where the last thing we needed was more podcasts, we present to you the Pods We Cast Along the Way.
Hello and welcome to the Pods We Cast Along the Way. I'm Spencer.
And I'm Ryan.
And you're tuning in to our 10th episode extravaganza. Lots to talk about. We definitely have a roadmap for this episode of all sorts of
absolutely,
wonderful things.
Absolutely.
10 episode retrospective and all that good stuff. But yeah, welcome.
Should this episode be a clip show, Spencer? Should we look back at these 10 episodes and go, ah, yes, remember the good old days 10 weeks ago?
You know, we have such a rich history of topics on this show. We could honestly do a clip show where it's just stuff that I didn't include in the episode.
Bloopers. We could definitely, I would love that. It's just like, oh, here's a little blooper from episode 3. And it's just us going... And then that's when I,
And then that's when, what was his name?
Just forget, like, those long, awkward pauses where we Google things.
We have to look up facts so we don't have to. We could do a supercut of all of our controversies on the last 10 episodes.
It's just a supercut of all of our apologies and all of our, just a supercut of all of our fans. So thank you, fans. Thank you, fan.
Good night.
Good night. I'm a fan of the show. Spencer, 10 episodes in, are you a fan of the show?
I am a fan of the show. We actually do have a handful of listeners. Our demographic is fairly far-reaching because my folks have shared it with all of their friends, and they actually really enjoy it. So maybe the demographic that we managed to achieve has not actually been in our age range, because no one can be ours to listen to our show.
What is our demographic like? Maybe we should talk about things our demographic likes. What are your parents like?
NCIS.
Let's talk about NCIS.
Okay.
Tell me about your favorite NCIS episode. Tell me about your favorite NCIS character, and tell me what you think NCIS stands for.
NCIS, it's a show. I think it's about Mark Harmon building a boat in his basement. And old people love boats.
Old people do love boats. They love the idea of boats. Yeah. I don't know. But once they have, like, a boat, like, on them, like, they don't know what to do with it. They're like children that
yeah,
way.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. No, I think boat ownership is one of those things where it's like, you fantasize about owning a boat, and then you have one, and then the real, like, sign of boat ownership is just complaining about owning a boat.
It's kind of like owning a trampoline. Trampolines are fun for a little bit, and then all of a sudden you have, like, I have this big thing.
What do I do?
It's taking up all this space.
It's one of my favorite Simpsons opening segments of all time is Trimbopoline. I think NCIS stands for not coming out of international syndication, because I think that show has 80 seasons.
It stands for Navy CBS. I'm sad.
Ryan, you were asking me before we intro the show a question about childhood possessions.
Yes. I've been doing, I've developed a hobby when I'm bored during all this going on, where I go into eBay and I just rank things by how much they're selling for. And I go, oh my God, like somebody wants like $10,000 for a copy of Pokemon Blue.
That's insane.
It's never been opened before. And I was like, man, like if I just like got that Christmas present and was like, thank you, and I just like never touched it, then I could be a 10,000-aire.
$10,000, which I'm pretty sure you have to pay taxes on.
Do you have something in your childhood that you look back on? Because, you know, there was kind of this mentality in the 90s that if you had something and you took care of it, then maybe one day it would be a collector's item. That's a lot of what Beanie Babies was, like the Beanie Babies trend. You know, you keep the tags on.
Let me tell you a thing, buddy. I had a lot of Beanie Babies as a kid.
Did you?
Still in a bin in my parents' garage somewhere. And I actually even got the little plastic tag protectors for the tags on the Beanie Babies.
You did not.
I did.
Wow.
I had an organizer for the back of my door as a little kid that had all my Beanie Babies in it.
What are those worth now?
Probably nothing.
Well, I don't know.
And that's the thing, right? It's like, I actually was very attached to my Beanie Babies as a kid, so would I ever sell them now? Probably not. Even though they're just sitting in a bin somewhere. The two things that I consciously preserved as a kid were a couple of Pokemon cards. I have an unopened Mystic Mew from the first Pokemon movie in a box. Yeah. And I also have an unopened holographic Machamp. Machoke, whichever the final one was. Which both of those are worth like nothing because one came in like every standard starter deck and the other was just a promo giveaway that everybody had. So I didn't really score saving those. But speaking of cards and things that are selling for a lot of money now, I actually just completed my Card Wars collection. For anybody who remembers Card Wars, which is nobody.
I don't remember Card Wars.
Card Wars,
I don't know what this is.
It was a collector trading card game, card battle game. It was the Adventure Time card game. It was like the in-universe tie-in card game that you could play. And they made a handful of collector decks, and they only did like one run of like collector packs, like expansion packs. So theoretically, it's possible to complete the series. And thankfully, I had collected most, if not all, of the collector packs. So I just had to snap up the rest of the decks I was missing. But I found out in like going down that rabbit hole that there were two promo cards that were released during that time. And one was in a DVD and the other was in a promo comic. And I had to find those on Amazon and eBay, and those are really hard to track down. So I put both of those in, like, they're unopened, and I put both of them in, like, nice protector sleeves. Not that I would ever sell them, because then, you know, collection wouldn't be complete, but they would sell on eBay. Like, there are some cards that are selling on eBay for, like, $30, which is a lot for a card game that nobody cares about besides me.
Well, I mean, that's the thing. Like, everybody cares about something enough to pay.
Yeah.
I think that's the big thing, like, looking at eBay, where I'm like, wow. Like, there's somebody somewhere that really needs this. There's somebody somewhere that really needs the box for Pokemon Snap. And they would pay $500 to get it.
That's insane. Did you save your game boxes? Like, your N64 boxes?
No. No, I never did. I've only done that for recently. I never did it as a kid. I always had like the loose stuff, but I had a little container that like a little shelf that I could pull out. But boy, my N64, I only had like, I think I had like 6 or 7 games. Super Nintendo, which we got in a garage sale, we just had this box of just like cartridges and stuff like that. I could still like hear the sound of like cartridges just like slamming against each other like that.
Yeah.
It's a good time.
Yeah. I saved Game Boy game boxes. Somewhere, theoretically, there is my original Pokemon Red box. So I've been starting a side project where I'm working on an original Game Boy DMG model. And you would be surprised how much those units sell for from some people. But because I'm modding it, I want to get a new case for it, different colored buttons. I want to get a backlit screen, kind of turn it and get a flash cart for it and turn it into a modern handheld, because those things are rough and tumble. And I think it would be fun to just have one as a little side project. But even then, looking online, some of them go for upwards of $100. And it's these were one of the most popular handhelds of all time. And yet the nostalgia of them kind of drives the market on that.
Oh yeah, it's dangerous. It's dangerous to because you see posts like that all the time, oh look what I found in my attic, or look what
Do you ever go on the retro gaming subreddit?
I think so, yeah.
There's my favorite kind of post on that subreddit is when you see people who are just oh, just went to a garage sale, got all this for $20. And it's every console, a Game Boy with every game. It's so clearly something. Or went to my grandma's house, she had this unopened in her attic. And it's their entire Game Boy collection. It's sure, you totally found that. Yeah, you're definitely not karma whoring. I always just, those are always just so funny to me.
I always liked that post that was I found this GameCube that was in the attic. And I looked inside and there were all these games in the disc tray.
Yeah.
And I looked in the
expansion slot. Yeah.
Yeah, and there's $10,000 in here.
Oh, but wait, there's more. I opened this compartment up and there's keys to a new car.
That's right. That's right.
There's a 20 pack of Stella in the that's my favorite parody post, I think, of those retro ones.
Yeah. I don't know. People pay big bucks.
They do.
They'll pay big bucks, and then that's another thing that I kind of discovered with this eBay thing is people will make reproduction cards.
Mm-hmm.
It's for super rare stuff, and so you have to look at these things and try to piece together oh, this logo is askew, this was made in China,
the texture on the cartridge isn't the same, right. Or whatever.
It's insane what people will pay for, especially something that they could easily play for very little.
On an emulator or whatever.
Yeah.
Well, getting back to one of our previous episodes, we were talking about game history and game preservation. Because it's obviously a legal gray area at best and just straight up illegal at worst to be selling a reproduction cart, because it's a cartridge that has the ROM flash to it that just looks like an original copy. But as original copies become harder and harder to track down, how do you feel ethically about people? Because these people who are buying these cartridges clearly want them to play them. And as it becomes scarcer and scarcer to find original copies of physical media, do you think that, what are your thoughts on that? Because there's part of me that's I wouldn't mind buying a repro card, but then there's part of me that's just but I want the original. I don't want a reproduction card. I want to play the original Banjo-Kazooie.
I think that's a big reason why they don't make classic consoles anymore, at least on Nintendo's side of things.
You mean like the NES and Super NES Classic?
Yeah, I still look online, they're still selling. There's still people that are I have this and will pay big money for it. But I think the reason they want to push their services and their saying hey, we have stuff you could download things, we have the subscriptions for service, is because having something that's very easy to load ROMs onto, it creates a competitor, and it creates this idea that if I have this thing that I could easily put things onto for free, then why would I pay for the service? Especially when it's a game that what's something that's impossible to play right now? A game GoldenEye. If you want to play GoldenEye, what do you need? You need the cartridge.
Mm-hmm.
and or if you want to play, I should say, if you want to play GoldenEye legally, like you need to cover
it. If you want to be a stand-up citizen about it,
yeah. So I don't know. It's this thing. I think if you have a repro card for one of those things, that's like, you know, how else am I gonna do it?
Yeah.
Like I see the value in that.
Yeah. Well, I feel that way to your point about the classic NES. It's like I really loved the Paperboy game for NES. Mm-hmm. But Nintendo's not going to release that on their online service, either because the license is all split up or because, you know, those things run out, or there's just no interest in it, you know. When you enjoy a minority, you know, fan-favorite game that nobody really cares about, where are you going to play it besides either on the original hardware or by finding a ROM of it? And that's difficult. And that's an argument, sort of, a negative point against their online service. But to answer your question, it's like, well, you know, why produce these consoles when we want people to invest in our service? I think for the Switch specifically, it's a great service because you can take them with you and it has online multiplayer function, which is why I wish they did more for their service. I mean, geez, it's been a year since the Super Nintendo Classic Library came out and they've added maybe like 10 games tops to it.
Yeah, it's scarce. It's always happened. It's always gotten scarce like that.
It's like, why are you gonna do this service if you're not gonna support it and seem like you don't care? And that's
right.
Very frustrating.
Yeah, I'm looking it up right now because I'm curious who made Paperboy. It looks like it was Atari. I know that back when I was a kid, when I was a young lad, we had a local swimming pool that had a Paperboy arcade cabinet and Donkey Kong arcade cabinet.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering if there's some way, like, you could get your fix.
You can get, they have a series called Arcade Classics on the Switch. Those are actual purchasable games where they are the arcade ports of things. Donkey Kong is on there. Super Punch-Out is on there. There's actually, like, over 100 of those classic arcade cabinet style games. Because what I think a lot of people in our age demo don't realize is that a lot of the games like Donkey Kong and Paperboy were actually ports of arcade games. Turtles in Time is another great example for the Super Nintendo. Like, that's more well known as having an arcade cabinet, but Turtles in Time, I think, is like the gold standard for arcade ports to a console, like, in that time. But then again, like, that's a really popular one that would do really well, and I think would be kind of a killer app for the SNES online service. But is Nintendo going to do it? Because I think that's a Konami title. And
it's Konami. It's intellectual property. It's owned by, like, another entity entirely. It's a mess.
Yeah. And I'm sure Konami would much rather make a Turtles in Time pachinko machine than actually re-release a quality game.
Exactly. You gotta have that pachinko. There's a Konami van that drives around my neighborhood sometimes, and I see it, and I go, whoa, like, you know, why is there a Konami van? And I go, oh, right.
It's casinos.
My state. It's a casino.
Oh, man. Do you think when you lose at the Konami Turtles in Time game, it goes, oh, shell-shocked?
Definitely does. You have to put in the code.
Shit, fuck it. I kind of want to play that now.
And you can, because you have that game, and I can't, because I don't.
Well, you could come visit, but you'll die because I have two cats now instead of one. It's twice the allergies.
That's why you got multiple cats.
It's because I secretly don't want you to come visit me again.
You prefer your cats. Spencer, let's switch things up for this commercial break.
Okay.
I want to play, let's play a clip from a previous episode. Do you want to set up this clip for a 10 episode?
Okay. Yeah, we'll play a clip from a previous
episode. Go ahead, Spencer, set up this clip.
All right, Ryan, so this is one of my personal favorite clips. And you know what? I'm going to keep this one a secret, but a lot of you are going to recognize this is one of our better-known segments that we actually got some feedback from our fans on. So let's take it away.
Thank you.
Yeah, Ryan, you know, during that break, speaking of well-known guests we've had on the show, I just want to take a moment of remembrance for Squat Diddley, who was massively obese and died of a heart attack in your driveway.
I guess he must have been, because he really waddled out of
the car. You know, he got afraid and he ran, and he just ate it right in your driveway. He died in your driveway. He died, and he is never coming back on this show.
Never coming back. He's still out there, actually. I never cleaned him up. I never called anyone. A lot of people just think he's a decorative log. I don't know why he decided to wear all brown.
Brown polyester is a power move in
it really is in
the talent representation business. So I'm gonna play just a little one of Squat Diddley's favorite music bits here. It was one of his favorite songs, and I think it would really do him a kind remembrance to play it for him. So we'll be right back. Wow, powerful stuff.
Powerful stuff.
Very powerful stuff.
Inside I'm crying, and outside I'm dead.
Yeah. Well, we're all dying, Ryan. It's the human condition.
It's true. It's true. You better get busy dying, or get busy.
Yeah. Samuel Jackson. It's great. Great movie.
It's the movie Samuel Jackson.
Okay. Instead of the Green Mile, it's the Purple Mile.
It's the Purple Mile. I like purple. It's my Samuel Jackson impression.
It's great.
Isn't it great?
Yeah, it's great.
It's just shouting. It's so good. So good.
No one's ever made that joke before.
No. Never. I lisp in real life. Did you know that?
Does he really?
He has a lisp or a speech impediment. I think Morgan Freeman has a speech impediment and Samuel Jackson has a lisp.
I think it's actually, no, I think what it is that Samuel Jackson had speaking.
I'm sorry, are you saying Samuel Jackson or are you saying Samuel L. Jackson?
Whichever the one is in Star Wars and Avengers.
I feel like you're not saying the L in Samuel L. Jackson. I feel like you're just going straight to Samuel Jackson like you know him.
Oh no, am I going to get a letter?
You're going to get a letter, and the letter is L, and you better fucking use it.
I would love to get, like, you remember the howlers from Harry Potter, where they, like, send letters, and they, like, scream at the recipient? I would love to get one of those from Samuel Jackson, where it's just him yelling at us.
He should have voiced the howlers in the movie.
That would have been great. I'm not going to do an impression, because that would be horrible.
I did the impression. You know, you gotta do the impression.
Okay, here we go. Here's
the impression.
I don't remember asking you a goddamn thing.
Spencer, I think now is a good time to kind of talk about our sponsor show. That show is, of course, Alt-Right, the Alt-Right podcast. Is there anything that you want to set up before we play this clip?
Yeah, you know, it's 10 episodes in, and we said, you know, gloves are coming off, so we're really kind of revealing ourselves, and yeah, you know, we're not even going to pretend anymore. You know, you joked about it being an alt-right podcast, and I think it's just time that we let the world know.
Yeah, I mean, this is who we are.
Yeah.
This is who we are. It's who we are.
It's who
it's
we
who
are.
It's who we are.
It's who we are.
It's who we are.
It's who we are. We're not fragile.
It's who we are. Alt-Right, the Alt-Right podcast. I am your host, Ryan Costello. With me, as always, is Spencer Richardson, here to tell you the truth in today's society as we know it. Our first topic, I will not apologize for apple pie. I will not apologize for baseball. I will not apologize for our first topic, which is not wearing a seatbelt. These liberal elites want us, expect us to go down the street to go down the highway with a seatbelt, and I'm here to say that if I want to go 90 miles an hour through my windshield, that's my God-given American right.
You know, first they started limiting where we could smoke our cigarettes, and then, you know, the next thing they're telling us that we have to wear seatbelts. You know, it's this is just typical people. It's like wearing all these masks during the coronavirus. If they're going to tell me that I got to wear a mask inside of all these business establishments, then it's my priority and it's my health, and I'm not going to look after anybody else. It's just like wearing a seatbelt, because if we start wearing seatbelts, what's next? What are they going to tell us to do? Start wearing dog collars? They're going to start rounding us up? They're going to start putting us in dog cages? That's not American.
The only seatbelt that I care about is the seatbelt that is around my waist, in which I carry 4 guns. It is around my seat, and that is how I see it.
And that's your God-given right as an American. If you want to carry 34 guns in your body to protect yourselves from the goblins that live out in the woods behind your house on your 34-acre ranch in Texas, that is your God-given right as an American.
We have a first caller here. We have a caller coming in here. This is Martha. She's 56 years old. She's very opinionated, and she has told us that she is not going to let anyone else talk but her through this entire argument. Martha, why are you angry?
I just want to talk about the skateboarders that keep skateboarding by my house. I don't like it because when I was young, only we were allowed to skateboard, if you know what I mean.
I know exactly what you mean,
that's
Martha.
Right. Only Protestants were allowed to skateboard in my neighborhood. And now they're letting any religion skateboard. I mean, what's next?
What is next? Are we going to have Catholic skateboarding? Are we going to have Baptist skateboarding? Nobody can skateboard. They don't know how to...
You're going to let these limp-wristed Episcopalians skateboard? They're already so weak already. You think they're going to have the fortitude to stand up on a skateboard? They're just letting anybody come into these churches and worship any way they want. What's going to be next? They're going to put them on... You're going to make them mobile by giving them boards with wheels on them so they can take their preachy, wimpy gospel across the neighborhood and across America?
You show me a Methodist who could kickflip, and I'll show you a pig who can fly and hurt. Her name is Rosie O'Donnell.
That's right. And by the way, why do we have to buy turkey bacon in the grocery stores?
All right, Martha, that's it for your time.
Okay.
That is our demographic, and that is how we're saying it.
I don't want to appeal to anyone under the age of 50, because if we appeal to anyone under the age of 50, then we may come across as people who are connected to our demographic.
How dare people go to our youth? Oh, go to our youth for our vote. We are going toward the top, and that is the top of the age limit, which, by the way, is 117 years old, and they own our network.
They do own our network, and actually, that's a great time to talk about one of our sponsors. You know, I'm an avid paleo diet enthusiast, and I just want to talk about one of my latest products. It's literally a packet of ground powder made out of bones and made out of chicken broth, and what you do is you grind that up with one of your protein shakes and you drink it. If you want to keep doing your God-given right as an American to vote in all these elections and vote Republican and keep fucking up the system for all those liberal cucks, then you need to take this product. How are you expected to live to the age of 150 to keep voting for all of these people in Congress who are so out of touch with the youth generation? I want people to keep voting for our age demographic because we're clearly the ones who matter and we're the ones who are in power. So grind up that bone powder and drink it and live to the age of 150.
Some people say that's bad for your colon. I say I had my colon removed. My entire body is just an esophagus that is just a hole at the bottom.
My colon was removed because it was making me inefficient. You think I'm going to be expected to wait 24 hours before I go from one end of the mouth to the other?
My appendix I removed because it was on the left side of my body. I demanded that the doctor put it on the right where it belongs.
I'm active all the time. You think I'm just going to sit there and let my body digest? That's a liberal, lazy thing to do. I'm efficient.
I spit out my own food. I digest it by hand in my wood shop, which is unregulated, and then I put it back in my body, and I do it all manually.
That's a very good point. That's a very good point. You know, speaking of points, I want to turn it over to our next segment here. This is one of our frequent visitors and contributors to the show, and one of our business partners here on Alt-Right. And we're going to turn it over to him for his next segment.
Now, according to a recent study, 2 + 2 = 4. Think about that for a second. 2 + 2 = 4. Nobody voted on that. Nobody was asking. But according to these so-called experts, 2 + 2 = 4, and if you dare to disagree, well, then you're a moron, or backwards, a fool even. Just goes to show how tolerant the left is.
Those are strong words about true Americans.
Those are very strong words about true Americans. You know what? I want to talk about something that's been on my mind lately.
What's been on your mind?
Something that's been on my mind lately, you know, ever since the election and President Trump, you know, hashtag my president, has been in office. He's been doing a great job. But I just want to talk about weak, limp Hillary. Where's Hillary been since she lost the election?
No one's seen her.
And we're here to bring you the truth on alt-right. And this may be difficult for some of you snowflakes to hear, but I just want to talk about how Hillary has been spotted in the woods outside of my ranch, rounding up kids, putting them in a big old witch's cauldron, and boiling them up for her liberal agenda.
I saw a sighting of Hillary Clinton once. It was in the lake. I got a glossy picture of her, and she, like, came up, but I only saw her shadow, but I'm sure I saw a pantsuit.
It's because Hillary's using that liberal Democrat technology that she's partnered with Bill Gates and Steve Jobs to make. You know, she's out there and she's got this confounding force field around her to keep people from taking photos of her. Why do you think we haven't seen her in the media at all lately? It's because just like Bigfoot, just like the Loch Ness Monster, Hillary is a mythical creature who is rounding up children and boiling them up in a big old witch's cauldron in her witch's lair in the woods outside of my ranch.
If you see Hillary Hussein Clinton, then you call us immediately because we are going to find her and we are worried about her.
We're worried about her because we want to drink her essences and her juices and distill her powers into a product that we can sell on this podcast.
Yeah, that's right. We hate her. We don't care about her well-being.
I'm getting all hot and sweaty just thinking about it.
I just want her to get home while be safe with her family. I mean,
you said you want her to be rounded up with her family because they're easier to target.
Yeah, put them all in jail.
Not because you're worried about her. Not because you're worried about her personal safety or anything like that. Because we hate Hillary on this program.
I don't find her slightly attractive. No, not at all. Like, just put her in jail.
I'm attracted to the classic ideal of American woman standing in the kitchen and wearing an apron and being a homemaker. Not powerful women in pantsuits. I don't find that attractive in the slightest.
Yeah, when I go home and like she's there and she asks me what's wrong and I tell her.
I don't lie awake in bed at night thinking about Michelle Obama and her beautiful toned arms.
Oh God, no! Oh.
Who would think of such a sick, disgusting thing?
Oh God, just like coming home and.
I don't envy her coming home to a loving husband and a couple of well, high achieving daughters.
Waking up in the middle of the night. And her going like, oh, did you have a bad dream? And then like, I go, I don't want to talk about it. And then she turns on the light and says, you can always talk to me. Like, I'm your rock. And then like, we talk long into the night and we hold each other. And then it feels like just briefly, everything's okay.
I'm not saying that, you know, we're not those liberals channeling our loneliness and our impotence into rage and outrage on a podcast that we force people to listen to so we can make money and feel important in this world where everything is just decaying like a dying star. The minute you're born, you start dying. I don't think about that line awake at night. That's for weak liberals to think about.
Anyway, that's the end of our show. Before we go, we'd like to end today with a quote from the most prominent alt-right celebrity there is. And that celebrity is Telly Monster. Telly Monster, who once said, R is a very good letter. That R stands for freedom.
That R stands for conservative.
That R stands for really good.
Those are powerful words, and you know, we take literacy very seriously on this program because we always want to be the most informed we can. That being said, we just want to take a moment to thank our sponsors before we close out. This episode has been brought to you by Audible because Audible is a great program. Audible.
Because reading is for nerds.
Thank you for listening. We'll see you next time here on Alt-Right.
Spencer?
Yes, Ryan.
I don't know if we should ever do an alt-right podcast ever again.
I don't think so either.
I feel cold.
I feel dirty and sweaty.
Which is why I've taken a bath and I've wrapped myself in an American flag.
It's the most patriotic way to get clean.
It's the most patriotic. It's not.
That's how you wash the sins of socialism away from you, brother, is you wash yourself in a clean bath made out of paleo water. Just like the caveman did, and you wrap yourself in an American flag, just like our ancestors.
Spencer, step out of it!
Oh, God!
Step out of it!
Oh, thank you. Okay. All right. So, back to our podcast, talking about video games. Hang on, I got to put myself in my happy place. Video games, irreverence, pop culture, things nobody cares about. Okay, we're back. Welcome back.
Spencer, you're back.
Welcome back to the pods we cast along the way. Whew.
Whew. You lost 130 pounds.
Just sweating out the... I you know, to get into that role as that Alex Jones type, I gained 130 pounds and ate nothing but bacon and steak for a week straight.
You went full Christian Bale, both in energy and commitment.
Yeah.
And for that, I thank you. You also yelled at a lighting guy. Remember when he yelled at that lighting guy?
You mean my Google Home? I yell at my Google Home for my lights all the time.
What if we found out this whole time, like, you know, he got all that flack and he was really just yelling at Siri?
Do you think that, you know, we talk about Hollywood and industry trends and things a lot in this show. Do you think that there is going to be a time in the history of film, because film loves to work off of gimmicks, right? There was that movie that was filmed on an iPhone. They're talking about shooting a movie in space next. Do you think there's going to be a movie that is written and filmed using artificial intelligence, meaning they will use AI to write the script, they will use AI to run the equipment, director, we'll say, is kind of hanging in the void, right? Maybe it'll have a director, maybe not. But do you think we'll get to the point where it'll be like a gimmick, where it'll be like the first movie ever directed all by AI?
I think it will, and I think it'll be awful.
I can't wait.
It'll be horrible. It will be like those. Have you ever seen those gag, Olive Garden commercial?
I actually, you were just setting up for a segment that I wanted to do. Can we read one of those here on the show?
Absolutely.
I would love to do a dramatic reading of the AI-generated Olive Garden commercial, because it's one of my favorite bits of all time. While I'm looking that up, Ryan, why don't you kind of set the mood, set us up for, you know, what these things are, because some people who listen to the show don't necessarily know, like, that this is sort of a gag, a meme that people do where they have AI write stuff.
Yeah, so basically, like, this is a tweet where somebody put up and said they put 1,000 hours of Olive Garden commercials into a computer, and then the computer spit out what the computer saw to be an average Olive Garden commercial. So
yes.
We're gonna give it a read.
So I'm gonna play a little background music here to kind of set the mood for the AI Olive Garden commercial. We'll take it away. Interior, Olive Garden restaurant. A group of friends laughs at a dinner table. A waitress comes to deliver what could be considered food.
Pasta nachos for you.
We see the pasta nachos. They're warm and defeated.
The menu is here. Lasagna wings with extra Italy.
We see the lasagna wings. There's more Italy than necessary. I shall eat Italian citizens.
Unlimited stick.
We see the unlimited stick. It is infinite. It is all. Leave without me. I'm home.
Gluten Classico from the kitchen.
We, the Gluten Classico, we believe the waitress that it is from the kitchen. We have no reason not to believe. Friend 4 says nothing.
What is wrong, Friend 4?
Friend 4 says nothing. Friend 4, what is wrong, Friend 4? Friend 4 smiles wide. Her mouth is full of secret soup.
Olive Garden. When you're here, you're here.
I love it. I love reading anything generated by AI bots. And who knows, if you enjoyed that reading, maybe we'll do it again on the show, and that can become a recurring segment on the pods
we cast.
Can we just get an AI to do the show? That'd probably do a better job than we do.
Have you not been using an AI?
Oh no, Ryan, you've discovered my terrible secret.
Have you not been using an AI?
Do 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 do.
Ha ha. Ha ha. Pop culture.
You know what? I'm gonna set a goal for us for our 20th episode / maybe season finale. Who knows at this point? I think that's gonna be the episode where we go full sitcom and have a laugh track and a sound effects board, and we just go super, like, what do you think?
I'm down for it. If you're down for the technical work of editing in laugh track.
Well, what I really want to do is, like, get a MIDI hookup going where I can just use a keyboard to cue it all, like, and do it live during the recording. So we'll start working on that. But You know, Ryan, you had mentioned, you know, our recommendation segment, and we talked about Frog Fractions was a game that you had recommended, and we will be talking about that on our next episode of the show. But it's now my turn to recommend something to you, and keeping with the frog theme, I want to recommend to you a movie that I watched the other night, and that is Hell Comes to Frogtown.
Hell Comes to Frogtown.
Yes, Hell Comes to Frogtown. A movie in which Rowdy Roddy Piper is a virile male in a post-apocalyptic America where sterility is rampant, and he literally has to bone his way across the United States, helping repopulate post-apocalyptic America. And along the way, they run into a settlement of aggressive mutant frogmen. It is the most insane premise for a movie I have ever seen. And if not for nothing, it is just wildly amusing. So hopefully you will enjoy that one. It gets a little risque. I will a little not safe for work in a couple of places, but nothing egregious. And it is kind of it's set up as a comedy, but it's one that's so ridiculous, I think, that you would find some things to enjoy about it.
Can I just say, I recommended to you a video game where you learn fractions and there are frogs.
Do you learn fractions, though? I guess we'll find out next episode.
Check, please.
Ryan, I think I want to take it to another music break. This is going to be our last break before our mid-season finale here on our 10th tencennial episode of the Pods We Cast Along the Way. And this one is just backed by popular demand. You know, the licensing rights just cost us a fortune. But we're going to play another Beatles classic because you folks requested it so often that we're going to play it here. And it's going to be a surprise. But I think you all know what this one's going to be. Here we go. And we're back. Ryan, I don't know about you, but that's one of my favorite segments on one of our previous episodes.
It sure was. You know, I sounded so young.
Yeah.
And now I'm old.
Yeah, it's true. Here at the end of our lives.
Here at the end of our lives, we know.
The days of our lives. We're going to rename. When we come back after our 10th episode, we take a little hiatus. We're going to come back. We're going to rename this podcast The End of Our Lives.
That's actually a great podcast name.
Kind of, yeah. Especially in the end days that we're in right now.
Wait, you know what? Can we switch podcast names midway? Is that allowed? Is that legal?
You know, I think it would cause brand name confusion, kind of like the whole debacle with HBO's naming convention. But I think it would be okay because no one listens to this show.
I don't know if it's legal. You know what?
We could always make a spinoff podcast and call it that. You know,
that's true. I guess we could. But I want to make sure. So you know what? I'm gonna call the mayor.
Oh, you're gonna call the mayor. So
I'm gonna call the mayor.
We've been trying to get a hold of the mayor for 10 episodes, and so this is pretty
momentous.
He always
wanted to be a guest on the show.
Yeah. So we're gonna get an interview with the mayor. I think every podcast wants to get an interview with the mayor. Like that's
we're
a status
symbol.
Yeah.
We're gonna get down to business. We're gonna ask. What are you gonna ask the mayor when we get him on?
I'm gonna ask the mayor what starter Pokemon he picked.
Okay. I'm gonna ask the mayor. How dare he?
Okay.
Hello, this is the mayor.
Oh, wow, mayor. This is incredible. I can't believe that we actually got you on the line. We've been trying for 10 episodes to get you. Yeah, so we just had, you know, I know you're a busy man right now. We just had a really couple of really pressing questions. My first question is, what starter did you pick in Pokemon Red or Blue?
Oh, well, you know, first of all, let me just say, as the mayor, like, all Pokemon, like, have merits. Like, all Pokemon, they care. They matter. You know, I always go for the underdogs. You know, that's why I always pick Bulbasaur, because Bulbasaur you know, not a lot of people know this, but Bulbasaur is actually fiscal conservative, which I agree with.
Wow.
Oh, okay. That's an unexpected answer, but very, very well thought out. Ryan, you had a question for the mayor as well.
Yeah, I had a question for you, Mayor.
Oh, yeah? What's your question?
Yeah, I wanted to ask, how dare you?
What?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask, like, how dare you? How dare you? You know, that's something that people ask.
Yeah, you know, when people get really indignant, it's just like, how dare you, Mayor? How dare you? How dare you?
I'm going to call the police.
What?
I'm going to call the police. I know where you live. I know you're Ryan, and I know you're Spencer.
Oh, sweet. You're a fan of the show?
I'm a fan of the show. I'm the one fan of the show.
Ryan, it's our one fan.
I messaged you on your first episode, and I sent it into the mailbag, and I said that the ghosts were after you. And now I know where you are. And now we can speak telepathically, and now I can do this.
Oh, yeah! Cue outro music.
Listening to this neat show. Remember to smash that like button and follow us on iTunes and Spotify. This has been the Pod We Cast Along the Way.